someone asked me about great Israel, great Jewish football players, and I kind of, after Sid Luckman and Benny Friedman and Julian Edelman, I kind of blanked out a little bit. So thought it just kind of, I wanted to kind of go through, just kind of highlight a few that maybe you didn't know was Jewish, if you can call that up, Rabbi. You know, so you see, you know, Lyle Alzado, who was a character, I didn't know he was Jewish. He's Jewish. You got Andre Tippett, probably the greatest Hall of greatest besides Sid Luckman, maybe the greatest Jewish player. He actually was a Baptist who converted to Judaism. He was a linebacker for the New England Patriots. Marshall Goldberg, the great player at Pitt, and then was actually starred with the Chicago Cardinals. He was on the 1947 team, the only Cardinal NFL champion. Josh Rosen, who was a great UCLA quarterback, kind of floundered a little bit in the NFL, but who knows, he could be on the Bears one of these days. As we mentioned last week, we have Mitchell Schwartz, who plays offensive line for the Kansas City Chiefs, and some other names on the other side of non-players. Al Davis, the great Just Win baby, Al Davis was Jewish, and not sure how much he espoused Jewish values given the recent documentary we saw, but he was Jewish. Art Modell, the owner of the former owner of the Browns and Baltimore Ravens. You see Robert Kraft there, Marv Levy. Ed Sable, who was one of kind of my heroes. Ed Sable was the founder and creator of NFL Films, the great NFL Films that really became the standard for filmmaking in sports. Sid Gilman, the great offensive mind, great coach, actually spent a little time with the Bears. And lastly, we had Ron Wolf. He was the architect of the great Packer teams of the 90s, and he was the reason why he brought Brett Favre to the Packers in a trade from Atlanta. And so he's the guy to blame for all the torment Brett Favre put us through for all those years. So just wanted to give those, throw those names out there and some people that maybe didn't know was Jewish in sports. And so thought that'd be a little interesting. Okay, so since this Summer Olympics will be in Tokyo, I thought it'd be a good idea to talk about Israel's history in the games. And if you can show that homepage for this year's Israel Olympic Committee, Rabbi. This summer, Israel is going to send, it's coming up here. Slowly but surely, for all the way from Israel. Well, we're waiting that coming. So is this summer Israel is going to send its biggest delegation ever? An estimated 85 athletes are going to compete in 18 sports. Israel even field a baseball team, and we're going to talk about that later with their baseball general manager, Peter Kurz from Tel Aviv. You know, there's high expectations. I think in judo, Israel has, as you'll hear, has got a pretty strong history in judo. So Israel's going to be there in the Olympics this year with 85 athletes. Pretty impressive considering the size of the country. And like most everything else about Israel, and the story of the Olympics is one of unthinkable tragedy and inspiring perseverance. You know, Israel, after being recognized as a country in 1948, they participated in their first Olympics in 1952 in Helsinki. And back then, the most notable achievement was a springboard diver by the name of Yoav Rahan finished ninth. And pretty much over the next, you know, 20 years, the most notable, you know, it was just about Israel being there to participate in the game. They didn't really have much success. And Israel didn't generate much news in the Olympics until, unfortunately, 1972, when the games were in Munich. I was 12 years old on September 5th, 1972. I was going to have my bar mitzvah a few weeks later. So that's nearly 50 years ago, I hate to say, but it's that long ago. And the Olympics, that was a really pivotal Olympics even before what happened. It was the first Olympics that really got everyone's attention on TV. It was, they ABC had the games and they broadcast the highlights at night, and they did the storytelling, great storytelling with the epic producer, Rune Arledge. and kind of got people really invested in the games. And there was a gymnast from Russia, Olga Korbut. Some of the old timers will remember her, kind of became this darling of the Olympics. And there was another athlete by the name of Mark Spitz, who also stole the spotlights. And Mark Spitz, who was Jewish, it was a kind of an interesting, very interesting character. I wrote in my book, This is Big, about the Big Ten. He went to Indiana. Prior to going to Indiana at 18 years old, he was the star swimmer going into Mexico City. But he also kind of was a prima donna. And he thought he was great. You know, he thought he was pretty good. And he was very disappointed in that Olympics, did not win a gold medal. And now he goes to Indiana. Indiana and the coach, Doc Councilman, actually had, this guy was kind of so despised by even his own teammates on the U.S. team for being such a jerk that he kind of had to ask the Indiana team, you know, do you want this guy to be on your team? And they said yes. And Spitz went there. And this Doc Councilman, who was a great swimming coach, the greatest of all time, kind of worked with him and got him to be a little more humble, a little more team oriented. And he had a great career at Indiana, and then it set him up for 1972 in Munich, where he won seven gold medals. And I've got this, just the little snippet of watching him perform in those games at Munich. Obviously, just a magnificent athlete, and ESPN in the end of the 20th century, when they ranked the top 50 athletes of the 20th century, Mark Spitz was 33rd. So he was the big star of that game, of those games. And then on the morning of September 5th, woke up looking forward to see more Olympics that night, and woke up to the horrifying news. And I remember hearing about what's this thing called Palestine. You know, what's Black September? I didn't even know what terrorists were all about. And this was kind of a new thing that happened at that game. And for me, for being 12 years old, who was kind of engrossed in all things sports, this was kind of, you know, it was pretty jarring to hear that the Olympics had been interrupted that morning very violently. And the night in Munich, it began in the wee hours of the night. Palestinian terrorists, posing as athletes, easily scaled a fence in the Olympic Village. In fact, they might have been helped by other athletes who were trying to sneak in past their coaches after a late night ramp at clubs and bars. And see, there wasn't any security at that Olympics beyond just having a fence, which obviously anybody with any kind of, anybody could scale. I mean, after the horrors of World War II, the Germans very much wanted to show how things had changed in the country. They promoted the idea of, quote, the peaceful games, kind of ironic given what happened. They thought having a huge security force would shatter the image of the peaceful games. And besides, nobody even conceived that there could be a terrorist attack at the Olympics. They built a fence that was easily scaled. They didn't even dream. And you contrast to today, you know, when we go through airports and everything, that the security of the Olympics accounts for more than $1 billion of the budget of a game. $1 billion goes for security. But back then, it was the cost of a fence, pretty much. And those Palestinians from an organization known as Black September quickly found out where the Israeli athletes were. They were housed in a building known as 31 Connolly Straza. And the first Israeli they encountered was wrestling coach Moshe Weinberg. He realized what was going on right away. and he got into a scuffle with the intruders, one of whom shot the wrestling coach through his cheek. And the wounded Weinberg was taken by terrorists to help find more Israelis. And he skipped past apartment number two, which the fencers and the shooters and the track athletes, guys who weren't the big guys, were there, and took them to apartment three, where the Israeli weightlifters and wrestlers were. And maybe it was assumed that he might have thought that the stronger man might have a better chance of fighting off the Palestinians. However, it didn't happen that way. The six athletes in that apartment were quickly captured by the terrorists. And while they were being marched back to another apartment, Weinberg again, sensing the gravity, once again attacked the intruders, even knocked one of them unconscious, and it allowed one of the wrestlers to escape via an underground parking garage. Unfortunately, the terrorists turned around and just riddled him with gunfire, and Weinberg thus became the first victim of the Munich massacre. There was weightlifter Yosef Romano, big man, born in Libya. He once inside that apartment, Romano, also sensing the gravity of the situation, also realizing he had to do something, tried to attack the intruders. He even slashed a terrorist in the face with a paring knife and grabbed an AK-47 from another one. But he was obviously outnumbered and he was shot to death. So boom, right away, two Israelis are dead. And now began a siege that lasted for 12 hours. The Palestinians demanded Israel release 200 prisoners and also wanted safe passage out of Germany to Egypt. Then Prime Minister Golda Meir and Israel refused to release any of the terrorists. We don't negotiate with terrorists. At one point during this negotiations, two West German ministers even offered to replace the hostages. The Palestinians said no. After 12 hours of tense negotiations in the Olympic Village, with deadline after deadline being moved back, the terrorists agreed to leave the compound and were taken together with the hostages by helicopter to a military airport. And the terrorists thought they were getting on a plane with the hostages to go to Egypt. Germans, meanwhile, had a plan to rescue the nine hostages and kill the terrorists at the airport. But it was a fiasco of epic proportions. In fact, they had snipers. Well, first off, nobody even thought to install floodlights so they could see. This was at night. And you have snipers there. They didn't even think to install, hey, maybe let's put some floodlights so the snipers can see who they're trying to shoot. They also had the snipers stationed in a way that their snipers were actually firing at other snipers. It was terrible. The Israeli officials were on site and they repeatedly offered their expertise to try to devise a plan. The Germans rebuffed them and they watched in horror as this entire operation backfired. Upon being attacked, one group of terrorists shot the hostages in cold blood. Second group of hostages died when a grenade was thrown into their helicopter. When it was all over, all nine hostages at the airport were dead and five of the eight Palestinian terrorists had been killed. And throughout the day, I want to show this video and people who remember that day will remember watching this. Throughout the day, myself and the rest of America tuned into ABC, where legendary sportscaster Jim McKay anchored the network's coverage. And you'll see a little snippets in this video, how we were watching this unfold in real time. It was incredible. At one point, it was even reported that the hostages had been saved at the airport. And ultimately, it was McKay who delivered the devastating news. And this is from a documentary, so there's going to be a little music behind it.
Good afternoon. I'm Jim McKay speaking to you live at this moment from ABC headquarters just outside the Olympic Village in Munich, West Germany. The peace of what have been called the Serene Olympics was shattered just before dawn this morning about 5 o'clock when Arab terrorists armed with submachine guns, faces blackened, a couple of them disguised as guards or as trash men in the Olympic Village, climbed the fence, went to the headquarters of the Israeli team, and immediately killed one man, Moshe Weinberg, a coach, two shots in the head, one in the stomach. This is building number 31. And we're moving in now on the windows behind which, at this moment, 8 or 9 terrified living human beings are being held prisoner. We are told that there are men with guns beginning to train those guns on the rooms where the two heads were sticking out a moment ago of the Arab guerrilla lookouts. I'm not sure these men have guns or cameras. That's a gun, all right. One man with binoculars, another with a gun. Whether they have a line of fire, whether they'll have to sneak up to the corner. This is happening now, if you can possibly believe that, at the Games of the 20th Olympiad. The latest word we get from the airport is that, quote, all hell is broken loose out there, that there is still shooting going on, that there's a report of a burning helicopter.
You know, when I was a kid, my father used to say, our greatest hopes and our worst fears are seldom realized. Our worst fears have been realized tonight. They've now said that there were 11 hostages. Two were killed in their rooms yesterday morning. Nine were killed at the airport tonight. They're all gone.
So they're all gone. The way he said that is one of the more famous, is one of the most famous lines, not only in sports history, but broadcast history, the kind of the emotion of they're all gone, and this, the emptiness and the despair that everyone felt at that very moment when he informed the world that all the hostages had died. And I was 12 years old. I watched that whole day. And, you know, prior to Munich, as I said, I didn't have much of a feeling that people hated Jews. I mean, I was very naive, very young. And that's, being the sports person that I am, that's when it first hit home for me that there were people out there who did not like Jewish people. And, you know, it was a very profound moment for me, and I'm sure it was for a lot of people. I mean, so the world reacted, obviously, in shock and horror at the attack. How did the Olympics react? You remember Avery Brundage, same guy who was the head of the U.S. Olympic Committee, who denied the two Jews we talked about last time a chance to run in Hitler's Olympics. By 1972, he was the head of the U.S. International Olympic Committee. And instead of calling off the games immediately, as Israel asked, Brundage and his committee decided to hold a memorial service the next day, with the games resuming the following day. Not all the athletes obviously stayed. Obviously, Israel pulled out, and Egypt also pulled out because they thought they might be targeted because the hostages wanted to go to Israel, Egypt. I mean, the terrorists wanted to go to Egypt. Various other individual athletes left the game as well. One athlete said it best. You give a party and someone is killed at the party, you don't continue the party. I'm going home. During the ceremony, 10 nations opposed to the existence of the state of Israel requested that their flags not be flown at half-mast. As disrespectful as this was to the spirit of Olympic competition, the IOC acquiesced and granted this request. And during his speech, Brundage, showing a complete lack of respect, incredibly said, quote, the games of the 20th Olympiad have been subjected to two savage attacks. We also lost the Rhodesian battle against naked political blackmail. Now, let's some background in it. So African countries threatened to boycott the Olympics of Rhodesia, now known as Zimbabwe, with its apartheid policies, were allowed to compete. Hence, Rhodesia was banned. So people were like aghast again that Brundage would lump that situation in the same sentence with 11 athletes at being murdered at the games he directed. And the games went on while Israel dealt with its grief and then its ultimate rage. Incredibly, a few months later, a Palestinian hijacking led to the Germans releasing the three surviving terrorists. Incredible. Now, really angered beyond, Prime Minister Golda Meir gave the okay for the Israeli Mossad to not only find and kill the terrorists, but also the individuals who were the masterminds of the attack. That story was told in the movie Munich. And by the way, Moshe Weinberg's son played his father in the movie. So you can imagine how powerful that must have been for him. And here's the meanwhile, this is another really ridiculous story that kind of came out of this. The widows of the slain athletes embarked on an absurdly long journey to get the IOC to recognize those athletes in a memorial at the Olympics. It should have been a no-brainer, right? Every Summer Olympics, they were rebuffed through the 2012 games in London. So you can imagine, they would try to do this and they wouldn't. The IOC said, no, we're not doing this. We're not going to make this a political statement. Finally, 2016, 44 years later, the IOC recognized those athletes in a memorial ahead of the games. The ceremony took place in a designated quote, place of mourning in the Olympic Village in Reno. Ilana Romano, a widow of one of the murdered athletes, told the Jerusalem Post, this is an extremely emotional moment for us, one we've been waiting for since 1972. Our patience finally paid off. The memory of the 11 Munich victims has finally been acknowledged by the IOC. And before I went, move on, I watched this was during a documentary on this, and I was so moved by it, I have to share it with you. This is really a documentary, a part that talks so much about the Jewish and the Israeli spirit. This speaking here is Anki Spitzer, a wife of Andre Spitzer, and she took the children of the same slain athletes, the 1996 games in Atlanta, and just remarkable what happened there.
Moments was at the Olympic Games in Atlanta. There we took all the children whose father was killed. There were 14. Many of those children, like my daughter, like Ilana's daughter, they never knew their father. These kids have always lived in the shadow of the Olympics. The Olympics were always something negative, and I want to show them what they really like, the glory of the Olympics, the wonderful feeling of being at the opening ceremony and seeing all these delegations walk in and feel part of it. So we did.
I remember the Israeli delegation were on the stadium and was going with the flags and... It was like see my father and his friends.
Now, for the first time in 96, a Palestinian delegation is walking at the opening ceremony. They are not members yet, but they are observers at that point. By that time, the kids were teenagers, and you know, I asked them, what are you going to do when the Palestinians come in? And they said, well, they're athletes, right? So we're going to applaud them too. They are not responsible of what happened then. And that was the moment that I said to myself, maybe our wish to educate them without hate in the heart, that is what came out here. This is what I see from these kids. This is what I wanted to reach this point, and I'm very happy about it. We don't hate.
Forty-three years after the chilling events of the 20th Olympiad, the Bavarian government of Germany and the internet.
Okay, there you go. We don't hate. I mean, that's just such a profound thing that happened and says so much about those, the parent, the mothers of those and the children. Just really, that just really was profound. And so what happened after 1972? Well, again, Israel, they could have easily stayed out of the 1976 games given what happened for safety reasons or other concerns, but that would have meant the terrorist won. No, again, the Israeli delegation proudly marched with the blue and white flag in the opening ceremonies in Montreal. And Esther Roth Sakamanov, who's coach, Mr., I'm probably butchering his name, Shapira, had been slain in Munich, clinched a historic sixth place finish in the 100 meter hurdles, the best Israeli Olympic track record to date. Israel continued to compete in subsequent days. And then finally in 1992 at Barcelona, Yael Arad was the big hope for a medal, and she did not disappoint. She was Israel's first medal winner with a silver in judo. And that was followed by the next day by Oren Samadra, also in judo, who won the bronze. The ultimate moment occurred in at the 2004 games in Athens. Windsurfer Gal Friedman made history by winning Israel's first Olympic gold medal in any sport. It's a dream come true, he said. It's unbelievable that I've become the first Israeli to win a gold medal. I felt like the whole country was watching and was pushing me from behind. Friedman then, noting the slain Israeli athlete, said he was going to take it to their memorial in Tel Aviv. Quote, to give respect for the people who were in front of me and killed while they tried to represent my country. So 32 years after the tragedy, they raised the Israeli flag and played the Israeli national anthem during Friedman's gold medal ceremony. A few years back, I did a presentation for a class at Bethel, and the teacher was Israeli. And when I played this video for the class, he was so emotional for him, he could not hold back the tears. He was just sitting in the back room crying, and with good reason. I mean, it's every time I see it, I get choked up, and I've watched this 100 times at least. And it's just so stirring, and I'd like to share this with you now. This is from the Israeli broadcast of that ceremony. So you'll hear them talking in Hebrew.
Gold medal and Olympic champion representing Israel, Gal Friedman.
Gal Friedman מישראל על הפודיום, מדליית זהב במסטרל, אתונה 2004. לכל אורך הדרך, גל פרידמן אמר, גם גור שטיינברג, גם יהודה מעיין אמרו, מדליית זהב זו המטרה. גל פרידמן הגולש היחיד מבין כל הגולשים בתחרות שסיים את כל השיוטים בעשירייה הראשונה, ואחרי ההישג הזה, מדליית זהב זה בהחלט, בהחלט ראוי לה.
Κυρίες και κύριοι, ο εθνικός ύμνος του Ισραήλ.
Ladies
and gentlemen, the national anthem of Israel.
על דוכן המנצחים באתונה 2004, הישראלי הראשון שמצליח להגיע.
I mean, that's just so powerful. And when you hear the Israelis in the crowd and how enthusiastic, it's just, it chokes me up. It really, every time I see it. And it's just thrilling to see that and know that happened. And to know that with memories of Munich forever embedded in our souls, thanks to that gold medal and hopefully future gold medal, we finally got to experience its moments. Israel finally got to experience its moment of glory at the Olympics. And now we look ahead to 2021. Recently, I did an interview with Peter Kurz from Tel Aviv. He was at his home in Tel Aviv. Peter's the GM of the Israeli baseball team that will play at the Olympics in Tokyo. And yes, Israel will have a baseball team in Tokyo. You want to play that video real quick here? Got it. I'm hitting it quick here.
Okay, welcome everyone. We are here with Peter Kurz, the general manager of Olympic Team Israel, and one of the guys who can, if you need something done, ask Peter. He gets anything done. He's an amazing guy for what he's done, and we're going to get into that story in a few minutes with Israel baseball. But Peter, I just thought, you know, you live outside of Tel Aviv. You've been there for how many years? You grew up in New York, but you've been in Israel for how many years?
35 years already.
35 years. So yeah. You know sports in the United States, and you know
yes.
sports in Israel. How would you describe the culture of sports in Israel? Where does it fit? I imagine it's not as big as it is in the United States, but what is the culture of sports like in Israel?
It's definitely not as developed as it is in the United States. It's very much on the European pattern, which is, first of all, the biggest sport here is soccer, and the second biggest sport is basketball. So those two sports are 90% of the sports that are watched and budgeted for in Israel. People watch them, but it's more, again, it's very much male dominated. 95% of the public that watches them are males. There's really not that much of involvement of females in sports watching. It's very violent, very male culture oriented, like in Europe. And that's the way soccer is around is in a lot of places. In baseball, we try to bring more of a family kind of orientation to it, just like it's in the States. But that's really an unheard of thing in this culture. There's also no real school sports. There's no high school sports or college sports. It's all clubs here. People maybe have heard of Maccabi and Hapoel and all those names. So those are all the kind of club system where if by the age of 10 or 11, you're not really, really good, you're not going to be playing much sports after that. It's really not that developed here.
It's not that developed. So, I mean, obviously you're trying to develop a Little League baseball program, but do people even like play tennis? I know there's two or three golf courses in Israel. I mean, sports isn't like a recreation, even from a recreation standpoint, like it is in the United States.
No, it's not. I mean, golf is really the very top 2% of the population, the ones that play golf, they might know about it. Tennis is a little bit more popular, but people are doing sports. People are doing athletics today because there's a lot of running. There's a lot of bicycling in Israel. I actually just started about 6 months ago. I started rowing. I started rowing on the Arkon River, like sculling kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And started doing that with my wife. And that's really been very enjoyable. So there is mass sports activities, but not really in organized sports. It's more, individual sports, running and bicycling and things like that. Not really team sports.
Do they celebrate their athletic heroes like from Maccabi and
years ago,
it's not like Tom Brady in the United States
not like the Super Bowl. Listen, 20 years ago, you had every Thursday night, you had Maccabi Tel Aviv on basketball. And and they were playing the European division. They were winning the European division. And that people used to watch religiously when there was one or two channels in Israel. Today, there's many more things to watch on television. There are many more things to see. And sports is not that popular. There's a small segment of the population, as I mentioned before, mostly male-oriented, who watch sports and follow sports, but not in the general population. You wouldn't, a general housewife or something wouldn't know the name of any kind of sports figures.
How about the Olympics? How are the Olympics viewed in Israel? And, is that something that I believe Israel's going to send about 85, the largest delegation ever, about 85, 90 athletes to Tokyo.
Right.
How do they view the Olympics?
The Olympics, again, like in the States, the Olympics are quiet for 3 years and nobody knows anything about those athletes. And then comes the Olympics and all of a sudden people are talking about track and field. People are talking about judo. People are talking about windsurfing. There's all those esoteric, more sports come forward at the Olympic time. It's the same thing here in Israel. Everybody knows about Yael Arad. She was the first one to get a medal for Israel in the Olympics. I believe it was in 92 in Barcelona. There have been 9 Olympic medals for Israelis, gold medal by Gal Friedman in 2004 in Athens. So people know the Olympic medalists. They get more information about it. I mean, judo is big. I think judo has like about half the medals. And when judo started about 20 years ago, getting more popular, people started playing judo. And you got a lot more kids going into judo. And that's the same thing that we hope will happen with baseball. The baseball team is now the first team ball sport to be in the Olympics for Israel in 45 years. Since the 1976 Montreal Olympics, when there was a soccer team, this is the first time that it's the first time there's a baseball team, of course, for Israel, but it's also the first time in 45 years that there's a ball team in the Olympics for Israel. So that's, people are very excited. When I came back from the qualifiers in September of 2019, and I met with the IOC, I'd been with them a year before, and I told them what we were going to be doing. And they looked at me very strangely and said, good luck, and come back when you qualify. And we went through 4 tournaments. I can tell that story another time.
Well, I want to wait a minute because I do want you to tell the story, but I just want to, one of the things that I read before the Olympics, the the Israeli delegation gets together and they do a memorial service type for Munich. I mean, how does, it's almost 50 years, you know, since Munich happened. How does that still resonate in Israeli society, especially around the, when the Olympics come around?
No doubt about it. Munich, for every sport athlete in Israel, Munich is in the back of his mind all the time. It's always there. Again, I brought over 20 guys from the States, Jewish American players who made Aliyah and became Israeli. They knew about Munich. I took them to the Olympic, the IOC building. There's an Olympic experience there. They saw it. They were there for about half an hour. It's a really nice thing, talking about Israel and the Olympics. A good part of that is about Munich and what happened in Munich. As you mentioned, every time, every Israeli delegation that goes out, before that, they meet with all these survivors of Munich, with the wives and the parents of the guys who were killed there, the guys who were killed in Munich. Also in the Olympic Village, in each Olympic, there's a ceremony there where all the Israeli delegation goes there and is at that ceremony. I'm looking forward to that because this is my first Olympics that I'll be there, but I'll be going to that. Just like the Holocaust, for almost all Jews, or either American or Israeli, is there in the back of their mind. The same way for all Israelis, Munich is in the back of our minds. There's no doubt about it.
And it's, and it's still something that's very, for someone who, you went through it and, you know, watching it in the United States, I was a young kid going through it. It's just an indelible memory that, this was so horrible. But it also kind of gets to the story of Israel. They came back in 76, they participated, the story of perseverance, which I think is so much part of the tradition and the mantra of Israel. Mm-hmm. What about Gal Friedman when he won that gold medal in 2004? I mean, there's great video of that celebration. It looked like it was the whole country exploded. I mean, right. was there that feeling of pride? Hey, we got our gold medal.
Yes, no, that was a good feeling. That was a very patriotic feeling in the country at the time. And again, the best thing is when you, to see him on that podium and to hear Atikva. I mean, Atikva for us, when I go to a baseball tournament and we stay on the first baseline or whatever, and there's Atikva there, I feel extremely, extremely proud. And there's no doubt, I mean, I'm taking a team of 12-year-old kids to Dubai. Yeah. And some of them were born in America and came on Aliyah maybe 2 or 3 years ago. And I know when they stand on that line in Dubai and they hear Hatikva, it's something that's in their hearts. It's something that's really there. Every time I hear that, I get more emotional. I've been hearing it for 30 years now. But every time I hear that, I get emotional, and it's something inside that you hear it. And certainly with Gal Friedman getting that gold medal was fantastic. And I hope in these Olympics now in 2021 in Tokyo, we get to hear Hatikva many, many more times.
Right. That would be great. Peter, I've got my kippa here from the Israel World Baseball Classic in 2017, right, where you guys had an incredible finish and really kind of showed the world that Jews can play baseball and Israel can play baseball, even with, American players. I mean, when I say that you can do the impossible, you're a true force of nature for kind of really starting something that didn't even exist. And now they've got a team in the Olympics. What's that journey been like for you?
I tell you, 2017, we played in the WBC. We were the last team to qualify for the WBC. We were called the Jamaican bobsled team by ESPN. And we went there, we went to Korea, and then we went to Japan with our team of Jewish American players. Because the rules are different there, you can have non-citizens playing for you as long as they're eligible for citizenship. So we went there. To make a long story short, we came in sixth place out of the 16 teams, which was an incredible, incredible event. And I came back to Israel after 2017 thinking, what's next? And on the one hand, I had a team of Israeli nationals, guys with Israeli citizenship who grew up here in the program. We were somewhere mediocre in European baseball in the B pool. And I had here a team of Jewish American ball players who really felt proud playing for Israel, having Israel across their chest, and really wanted to go on and do more. So in 2018, I spoke to 10 of the guys and I brought them here in Aliyah, and they came and made Aliyah to Israel. They became Israeli citizens. I said, listen, there's a chance. In 2019, we can go to the qualifiers, maybe. There's a chance we can do something. We have to get through the B pool. We have to go through 4 different tournaments in 6 weeks, and maybe we can do something. In Europe, everything in Europe. Maybe we can be the European representative to the Olympics. I thought we'd get to the qualifiers and we would lose there, but they all came. They made Aliyah without any promises, without any commitments. We went to Bulgaria, we won that tournament. We went to Lithuania, we won there. We went to Germany for the European Championship for the A pool. I added 8 more players then. I added Danny Valencia. who became Israeli.
Former major leaguer, right?
Ex-major leaguer, exactly. So we went to Germany to the A pool, and we came in fourth place. And the top five teams went to the European qualifier the following week in Italy. So we were the top five teams of Europe plus South Africa. We played a tournament, and we then defeated Spain, who was just the third place country a week before, Holland, who was the first place country in Europe, and Italy, who was the second place country in Europe. And we defeated all three of them day after day. And the guys got more and more confidence. In the end, we defeated South Africa, and we became the European African representative to the Olympics. And the rest is history. So we've been waiting for an extra year because of the Olympics have been called off. But we've added more players so far. We've added a guy, not much of a career, Ian Kinsler, four-time All-Star.
He's going to be playing. Wow.
He's going to be playing for us. Yes, he became an Israeli citizen. Ryan LaVarnway, who was the first Israeli to play in Major League Baseball last year, he'll be playing for us. Dean Kramer will probably not be playing for us because he's the second Israeli, the first Israeli to pitch. And he was born Israeli because his parents are Israeli, but he'll probably be in the major leagues in next summer. So he won't be able to pitch for us, but we're building a good team. We're going there. We're going with confidence. We're raising money now with the JNF Project Baseball. And we're also going to be having a mini camp in the United States in July in all the Northeast. We're going to be barnstorming across the United States, in the Northeastern United States, and then going to Tokyo and hopefully winning a medal. That's our goal, to win a medal.
That would be great. What's the awareness of baseball in Israel, and how will this, you know, increase that awareness by Israel having a team in the Olympics?
The awareness among the sports community is there. The sports community knows that there's a baseball team. They know we made the Olympics. The general public, I don't think, knows it. I mean, it's been reported and everything, but the general public really doesn't know it. That's why in the next 6 months, we're going to be doing a lot of PR. This tournament going to Dubai with the 12-year-old kids is part of that, to really, you know, it's the first time an Israeli national team is going to Dubai. And that's because of the Abraham Accords and the peace treaty we have with them. That will be reported in the news. And as we go along, things will be more and more reported in the news. And we hope that coming back and having a medal means that our sport, which maybe today has about 1,000 kids and adults playing here, our goal next year is to have at least 2,000 or 3,000 kids and adults playing here. By the way, we're also building two fields in Israel, which is a first, because we've been raising money for about 10 years with the JNF, and we're building a field in Beit Shemesh and a field in Ra'anana. So we're hoping that with the fields, with the interest and everything, with the medal that we get from the Olympics, we can really build up baseball here in Israel a lot.
And the kids, I mean, when the kids do play, what kind of reaction do you get from them? You know, what's because it's a different kind of game. It's a new game. I bet you they love it. They have to love it.
No, well, first of all, the kids in Israel think it's an American game, even though baseball is played all over the world. As we know, it's played in Far East. It's played in South America, but they really see it as the American game. So they come out there wanting to be like the Americans. When we bring our Olympic players there, they love it. They love to be with the Olympic guys. They love to see them. They've been here about three or four times in Israel. They'll do clinics all over the place. They love the kids. The kids are in touch with them. They're mostly in the States now, our Olympians, because they're all playing either minor league or independent league baseball. So they're all there practicing and getting ready, but they're in touch with all the kids here in this program. I mean, they've seen, Ian Kinsler was here for 3 days. He must have seen at least 400 kids in those 3 days. We couldn't drag him off of the baseball field. He loved being there, and he wants to come back again. He wants to be here a lot, and kids are in touch with him today. I mean, he's, you know, corresponding with kids all the time.
They really see
themselves as ambassadors of baseball for Israel, definitely.
And that's a great story, and you know, and we're going to all be watching here. As you know, maybe Israel plays United States in a game. I mean, who do we run? You know, who we
get? United States is not qualified yet.
There's
going to be six teams. Israel, Japan, Korea, and Mexico have qualified. There's two more qualifiers in June. The U.S. has a chance, but who knows?
Well, but it's going to be a great story. And you know, and I talked to a few of the guys, and what the feeling they're going to have when the opening ceremonies will take place. And the feeling, I asked them what it's going to feel like when you march in under the Israeli flag, and they were, you know, I don't even know if they could even comprehend all the emotions that they're going to have. I mean, you talked a little bit, just the sense of pride that you have in representing Israel. But what's that been like for you to take national teams?
It's incredible. I mean, I was born in the States, but I feel so Israeli now, living here for 35 years and everything. Actually, here in Israel, I'm more the American than anywhere else, because here I'm more identified, especially, you know, running baseball and everything. I'm more identified as American here. But I still, I mean, 35 years in the Army, doing, you know, Army service, doing reserve duty and everything. speaking fluent Hebrew, having a wife who's Israeli, but still the pride of wearing this flag and being there and everything is incredible. The blue and white, having Israel across our chest, it's an incredible feeling.
Peter, it's been great to have you. Thanks so much. I'm telling you, if anyone needs something done, whatever it is, you want to ask Peter, because Peter will get it done. What he did.
Thank you very much, Ed. Thank you very much for everybody. And support Team Israel.
Will do. As I said, Peter's just a true force of nature. He's just amazing. There is an Israel baseball Facebook page, so you should go and look for and follow that. You can see about what's going on with the Israeli Olympic team. And Peter, I've known him for a few years now, and just really just a remarkable guy. And so it's a remarkable story. And is all of Israel in the Olympics. And so hopefully we'll see more stories. And we just want to conclude here. There was a story in the foreword. Was it last week, Rabbi? A few other people sent it to me too, if you want to call this up. I think it kind of gets to the heart of what we've been talking about here. We're living in the second golden age of the Jewish athlete. And it just goes through what we've talked about for these last three sessions, that there are a number of great Jewish athletes that are really taking the stage right now and making a name for themselves in many different sports. I didn't even realize that the, and from reading that story, I forgot to mention that Jason, you might know this, the number one draft pick in hockey this year is Jewish.
Like this Lafreniere.
Yeah.
So,
was a guy named Hughes or not? I thought there was a guy named Hughes.
No. I'm sorry?
Yeah, there's a Jewish, the number one draft pick for the NHL was Jewish, isn't he? Yeah.
For last year?
Something like there was a guy named Jack Hughes or something.
Oh, Jack Hughes. Yeah, a couple years ago.
A couple years ago. So he's Jewish.
Yeah.
And as we said, there's a basketball player, Israeli basketball player playing for the Washington Wizards. So it's just a great time for to kind of see what Jews are doing in sports, and hopefully we'll have a great Olympics. And as we've got a couple minutes here, if there's any questions or comments, we can take them now.